Around 20 years ago, at the beginning of my career as a cognitive neuroscientist, I presented some research findings on human brain functions. And later, during discussion, someone asked me a simple question, but one with enormous implications. What do you think makes us human? Well, my response not only reflected my scientific view, but also my perspective on human beings for almost two decades. And his question was justified because understanding ourselves means exploring the brain, an extraordinarily complex organ with up to 90 billion tiny brain cells. That small to be invisible to the naked eye. If this amounted to brain cell, this would be the ratio to a human hair. And each brain cell forms thousands of synaptic connections to each other. So together, these connections form a network of up to 100 trillion connections. This is one with 14 zeros. And this huge network, this huge number of synaptic connections, can have an unthinkable number of different combinations of neural network activities that actually represent our whole world. And the symphony of these neural network activities is actually what makes up our brain. And if you think about it this way, it makes a little bit more understandable that the task of the deciphering the brain is one of the greatest challenges for mankind. And the advances in science had a clear explanation for human brain functions. Our thoughts, memories, emotions, personality, self-awareness, all our experiences are the result of the neural network activities of our brain. Well, this is why I answer the question confidently. Our brain makes us human. Well, this is both biological and consequent. But this biocentric view was also groundbreaking and opened doors to explore the deepest secret of our mind using scientific methods far from unproven theories and assumptions. And the theory and the scientific view of life was also very much in line with the view of the human brain functions. So, hence our understanding of ourselves became a part of the biological life, as described by evolution, from simple molecules to stable polymers, from self-replicating genes to the first protocells that, through adaptation and selection, evolved into a diversity of complex organisms and life on Earth. And finally, and as the culmination of more than 3 billion years of evolutionary history on Earth, to become highly developed humans with our extraordinarily complex organ that can tell its own story here at TEDx. What a story. Well, I love this story because it reflected also my scientific view until then. But today I want to talk about a different story, a story that goes beyond biology. A fascinating but last noticed story played out in the shadow of biological evolution. The story of evolution of knowledge. Well, in this story, information is described as the core of evolution, but not entirely biological. And the idea that evolutionary information does not require a biological medium was not common in science. So basically, this story is the sequel of our own history. And this story should be told. Because I think one of the fundamental insights is revealed here. Over the past centuries, a key shift changed our world. I'm not talking about technological discoveries, which are more a byproduct of it. It is the approach itself to expand our knowledge, better known as empirical science. Empirical science is a matter of knowledge acquisition based on the principle of falsification. This is essentially kind of a pact to refute knowledge rather than trying to confirm it. And this is of crucial importance. Let me explain you why. After 40,000 years of modern human history, what do you think we know with absolute certainty until now? Only one knowledge, if any, comes closest to truth. Only one insight is and must be recognized by science as closest to truth. But the acceptance of this one realization changed everything within a few centuries. And the only one understanding is the ironic realization of humanity that we are not and will never be able to recognize the absolute truth. It is practically impossible for us. Our brain can represent everything only as neural network activities. And the representation of the reality, well, it cannot be the reality itself. Let me try to demonstrate, okay? Take a look at this apple in front of you. Well, it seems like if you're seeing it directly with your eyes, but this is not entirely correct. The headlights hit the apple, and some of them get reflected. The reflected lights hit your eyes, but the actual seeing does not take place there. The lights only activate the photoreceptors in your eyes and get then transmitted to your brain. And here is something fascinating begins. In the darkness of your skull, where no light can reach, the bright image of this apple is created. It is not the apple itself, but only a complex sequence of neural network activities that represent the apple. Even if there is no apple in front of you anymore, even if you close your eyes, even if you lose your eyes, you will see the same apple if the same network is activated in your brain. Doesn't that sound incredible? But this is how our brain works. Okay, let me try it to make it a little bit clearer, okay? Imagine you're recording the same apple with your cell phone, okay? The image of the apple would be displayed on your phone. But it is obvious it is not the apple itself, but only a complex combination of activated pixels on your display that represent the apple, right? Even if there is no apple in front of you anymore, even if you're at home later and play the recorded clip again, the image of the apple would be displayed. And even if the camera lens of your cell phone broke on the way home, the image of the apple would be displayed, right? Everything we experience is the brain activity that represents our whole world in this way. That's why we cannot absolutely verify that it really is an apple, but only falsify with uncertainty if it is not an apple. Okay, here is the good part, yeah? Even if we cannot recognize the absolute certain knowledge, we can refine, we can optimize our knowledge through empirical science. Empirical research only investigates observable ideas and analyzes them until they get selected or adapted. We cannot grasp the reality, but this principle leads to permanent optimization of our knowledge. And it is interestingly similar to evolution, okay? A kind of evolutionary thinking, if you will. The ideas are tested, refined, and discarded, and the strongest ideas survive. And after many, many passionate efforts, something magical happens. It starts to optimize itself, terribly achieving an exponential efficiency. Whereas only a few hundred scientific knowledge was publicated every year, scientific knowledge grew exponentially, so that today more than millions and millions of publications are publicated every year. Empirical science forces the exponential growth of scientific knowledge. In this way, empirical knowledge is evolving increasingly faster and faster, which leads also to more frequent refuting of knowledge, revision of scientific knowledge, even of the general scientific views, such as the biocentric understanding of human brains. Let us, for example, to realize that everything we attribute to human brain functions, such as thoughts, memories, emotions, personality, consciousness, intelligence, all these are merely complex information constructs that can meanwhile generate it non-organically, technically, non-biologically. They can meanwhile even build themselves on its own. For a long time, we thought that evolutionary information always needed a biological medium, but for the first time, it is possible for this kind of information to sustain, replicate, and optimize itself beyond the biology. We are at the beginning of a new era where not only Homo sapiens can write and dominate history. New forms of intelligence and consciousness are emerging, and critical thinking or creativity are no longer the only and exclusive domains of humans. Science has reached a decisive climax where the boundaries between the biological and technical forms of life and evolution are becoming increasingly blurred. Well, if you ask me today, what makes us human. I think I could no longer simply say that our brain makes us human. Perhaps we are more information constructs that our brain possesses, well, at least for now. The next stage of human evolution could be more informational and less biological. So the change from a biocentric view to a technical-driven, transhumanistic approach is shaping the world around us. Also, we all notice the changes every day around us. It is the story of the evolution of knowledge through empirical science that began centuries before. Ladies and gentlemen, I invite you to consider our role in this exciting and rapidly developing contemporary world. It is time to broaden ourselves, to responsibly shape our future. My name is Yildiz. Thank you very much.